Reading from Still Life with Woodpecker. A sort of a love story. Tom Robbins. Okay. Let's get this porcupine on the street. A race of carrot-top demigods, known everywhere as Redbeards, appeared at various places in the ancient world, transforming the natives, spurring them to develop highly advanced civilizations in a very short time, leaving behind vast pyramids and other solar-lunar architecture when they suddenly and inexplicably disappeared. That much is a fact. It is also a historical fact that the Chavin, Mochica, Olmec, Zapotec, and Toltec peoples also vanished abruptly and without explanation. Apparently, the Redbeards had powerful enemies, capable of zapping whole civilizations into other dimensions. If the Redbeards were extraterrestrial, a lunar race dispatched to Earth, for whatever reason, from the planet Argon, then their enemy would have been a solar society, the blonde Argonian ruling class. Call them Yellowbeards. When the Yellowbeards learned what the Redbeards were up to on Earth, they immediately zapped the people with whom they were conspiring. Poof! Off went the Chavin, next the Mochica, then the Olmec and so forth, transplanted each in turn from the universe to the anti-universe, leaving no forwarding address. Friendship with Redbeards bore a certain liability. Finally, the Redbeards themselves were zapped. This occurred shortly before the arrival of the conquistadors in the New World. When the Spanish priests heard tales of Redbeards, they naturally labeled them devils. It's no coincidence that Satan is usually depicted as being as red as boiled crabs. Stuck in the anti-universe, still the Redbeards did not give up. They had faith in the potentiality of Earthlings. Maybe they felt that alone in the universe, we here on Earth, perhaps because of our close proximity and special relationship to our moon, possessed the humor, the playfulness, the romantic sentiment, the general warm and honorable looniness to counteract the rigid solar efficiency of the Yellowbeards. Surely, the Redbeards would not accept that the pyramids have been built in vain. Therefore, they attempted to re-establish contact with Earth. Of necessity, communication would have to be telepathic, and it would have to rely primarily on simple visual symbolism. Since the so-called anti-universe is a mirror image of the so-called universe, words would be reversed as they crossed from one dimension to the other. And language, even when translations were faithful, would make no sense at all. So the Redbeards beamed their telepathic vectors into earthly dimensions. Only a few humans responded, and they, exclusively redheads. Maybe a trace of racial memory, an ancient residue of Argonian DNA remained in their genes, and the response was far from desirable. Reception of the extra-dimensional transmissions confused them and frequently brought them grief. For example, Vincent van Gogh, the most famous redhead omitted from the 12 most famous redheads list. Egad! Took to painting vases, faces, chairs, stars, etc. As if they embodied the life force. Which they likely do, as if there were vibratory fields, auras around them, which there probably are. But everybody thought poor Vincent on the weird end of the banana. And eventually he was driven to take his own life. After several centuries of similar failures, the Redbeards refined their technique. They began to concentrate on a specific red-headed individual with a specific end in mind. Thus, they were able to influence Thomas Jefferson, an ideal receptor because of his wide-ranging sensibility, to affix a pyramid to the first American paper money issued since colonial days. When, after a century, that play hadn't turned any big tricks, they beamed to the brain of a red-headed lithographer a more ambitious transmission. The Redbeards had established a telepathic broadcast path, a channel that cut directly and deliberately through Washington, D.C., the most important of world capitals. Development of Camel cigarettes was occurring. Fortuitously, within the mainstream of that channel, in 1913, most smokers rolled their own. Manufactured brands were just barely catching on. And while Fatima in Boston and Philadelphia and Picayune in New Orleans were gaining appeal, Camel was to be the first cigarette to shoot for national, later international, distribution. Moreover, R.J. Reynolds' recipe for Camels called for a substantial amount of sweetener. Sugar, like lust, accentuates the reddish pigment in the hair and our freckles of lunar-oriented people, especially when they're exposed to direct sunlight. Lee Cherry had learned that, he really did learn that from bona fide yellow-beard Argonians. All right, I had to share that with you.